Okay, we're in the studio, the Chopra Studios here in Lower Manhattan. And today I'm excited that we're going to talk about something which I've neglected, actually, and I apologize to all my hundreds of thousands of listeners, or as most people know it, my family, to talk about film composition. I mean, this is, I have to say, this is something I should have been talking about a long time ago, but the good news is we're doing it now. And what's great, the great timing is we can also promote Blake's book, Blake Fichera, who's, I'm going to fuck up your name again. Remember last time it took me like 40 times?
Fichera.
Yeah, Blake Fichera, who's written a new book called Score to Death, which is, by the way, a fantastic title.
Yeah, a friend of mine came up with that.
You know, you could take credit. Well, unless the friend listens in. It's called Score to Death, which is really clever. Conversations with some, not all, of horror's greatest composers. So it's an interview format book. And the good news is we're also joined by one of the composers, Jeff Grace. Hi, Jeff.
Hello.
One of horror's greatest composers.
Well, it's very... And, you know, if that weren't enough, and I think at least one of us thinks it could have been, Larry Fessenden, who's been on this podcast, I think, two times already, two times too many, as far as he's concerned. Hi, Larry.
Hey, guys. Hey, Adam.
Larry, you wrote the foreword to this book. Just coincidentally, I opened it up today and I saw your name in it.
It's incredible. The coinky dink.
It is.
Blake got in touch with me. It was late in the game. I believe we were on a bit of a deadline. He just said, did I want to write something? And I was delighted to get a PDF of the material and glance through it and just found it a very stimulating. They're really in-depth interviews, and that's what makes it special. It's not superficial. You get a real taste of each of the different interviewees, their approach, and it's really valuable. I think you're right that this isn't the most common topic. You know, we learn about makeup artists and obviously directors and writers, but we don't hear about the musicians, and really so many great films are, known because of their music, from The Godfather to Jaws to Bernard Herrmann and and the Jeff Grace work as well.
Exactly. I'm a huge fan of the films that he has created. And, you know, I'm going to play the devil's advocate a little bit, which is a great expression for today, the devil's advocate. But and that is like,
and what, know, a picture.
Yeah, see? And, you know, if I was talking to Blake before we got on the studio, and, you know, I can even admit that taking this for granted, that's why I've gone 360-some episodes in without doing a segment on film composition, because most people just take the music for granted. I guess that's kind of what you were just trying to say, right?
But I think... At the same time, people will sort of reference the score, even the Christopher Nolan Batman. And as I said, most people know that Bernard Herrmann is creating that particular vibe that you get out of a Hitchcock movie. And I think, and the Tim Burton vibe is really associated with Danny Elfman. I mean,
sure.
Think of these directors, and they have their compatriots who really have done a great deal to put that stamp on the movies, which you just associate with the director.
Blake, when you were writing this book, obviously this was a subject that was really important to you and something you're crazy about, but did you think of the audience for the book? Do you think it's for, is this for the film community, or do you think this could go, this can transcend is the word I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Could this transcend to a more general audience? I mean, certainly horror film lovers, fanboys, genre film.
I mean, when I wrote it, it was more, I kind of wrote it for myself. I couldn't really find a book like it. I had
That's called a diary.
I found some interview-based books about film scoring in general, and I found some essay-based books about horror music, but I didn't find, like, the horror composer's interview book. And a lot of the composer-oriented, like, interview books that I had read were very much based around music theory and stuff.
So it was really even more inside baseball, you could say. And, this is more about
So my goal was really
origin stories and that kind of thing.
I mean, my goal was really to make a book that the fans of horror movies and the fans of horror movie music would like and be able to follow. But at the same time, talking to anybody about their process and the business in general, I feel like there is a lot of really valuable stuff for people that want to be composers in the film business and that kind of stuff. So it was kind of, I guess I wrote it with both in mind. And the other thing about a more general audience, surprisingly, like very little of the book is about horror movies. You know, it is a lot of what's in there is kind of backgrounds about the composers and process, which is not specific to horror movies. I mean, we do talk about specific horror films and the way music works in horror films, but a lot of it is just about the art of film scoring.
Well, I do want to come back to the process and the common things you found about process, since that's a central thread that runs through all these interviews. We're here again with Jeff Grace, who is a fine composer of many of my favorite horror films. So thanks again, Jeff, for coming in, because this is great. What do you think in terms of the composer? Do you think it's a kind of an unsung role? I mean, I know you're very, very subjective.
Yeah, sometimes very much so. But in a way, I think that's kind of part of the job as well.
Yeah.
I mean, we talked about it in the interview. I think a composer's job is to kind of bring the audience into the world of the film. And a lot of times that means without being noticed so much, you know, not hitting them over the head, at least. Occasionally you have to hit them over the head, but not usually. You don't want to do that. You don't want to draw too much attention to yourself. So if you're doing a good job, you're kind of flying under the radar in some respects. But like Larry was saying, I mean, I think especially when you have very effective scores or memorable scores and then director-composer relationships, then you start to, you know, people start to appreciate it a bit more. Yeah.
Alex, how does he sound, by the way? I'm sorry. A little. He is a little low, right? I think he's talking right into the mic. I'm sorry, guys. One second. Can we turn him up a little or something? Or just because he's a little soft in my head. That's not you. I think it's the.
Is that good? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah, you're fine. So Jeff, your filmography is great. You seem to work, which is probably typical, with repeat business is essentially what I'm trying to say. So I know you work a lot with Ty West, with Kelly Reichert, Jim Mickel, among others,
and
you know, it's amazing. What?
Larry.
Larry? Oh, Larry Fessenden. Yeah,
the other guy.
Of course. Well, Larry's produced almost all those, right? Like, or at least had a hand in.
Yeah. And then we did the radio. He's got a radio show that we did.
Oh, right. You did the music. You do the music to all of the Beyond the, what
Tales Beyond the Pale?
Tales Beyond the Pale.
I did the theme music, and then I did a number of the episodes, at least in the first season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Larry,
I always joke that Jeff just pulled that theme. I think I asked him almost as a favor, and it's probably the most used piece of music you've ever created.
Right? You're saying you use it all the time.
We could have a conversation about that later, Larry. No, just kidding.
Yes.
Process. Blake, what did you find out about process maybe that you weren't anticipating? Or maybe what is a very common thread about different, all the process from, you know, since you have how many composers you interviewed? 14 different. Were there any others that you didn't include that you're sitting on?
No.
Bonus
no.
features?
I mean, there was obviously there were people I would have loved to talk to, but they just didn't work out. If we ever do a volume two, maybe we'll get to talk to some of them too. But I'm really pleased with the kind of variety that of composers that are in the book, which was kind of really on my mind when I was trying to come up with who I wanted to talk about. I mean, who I wanted to talk to. I wanted to get kind of different age groups and different backgrounds.
Right.
And some of the guys are from Italy and stuff like that.
So. Right. The Dario Argento school,
yeah.
That kind of thing. So since you bring it up, or we brought it up, just a handful I'll mention here is Simon Boswell, John Carpenter, who I didn't know until I, you know, was reading the book, that he scored his own films. I don't
most
know
most of them. Yeah,
didn't know that. Jeff, of course. Tom Hajdu, how do you pronounce that?
I think it's Hajdu or Hajdu. Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm asking. Because
he's part of a composing team called Tom and Andy.
Oh, I see. I actually have a collection of his music, which is written for, like, old porn themes, I believe. I, of course, didn't purchase that. It was given to me. Harry Manfredini, did I pronounce that right? Yeah, Harry Manfredini, and others, et al. So it's really a comprehensive book for anybody who's interested in film composition at all, let alone horror film. And if you're a fan of horror films, perfect reading for you.
Yeah.
And Jeff, just tell the story how you got to, was it almost incidental in the sense of you were just sort of already a musician, right? You grew up a musician.
Yeah.
And you got hired by what's the composer? Howard Shore's company?
Yeah. I was his assistant for a number of years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you weren't planning on going into film composition. You just ended up getting a job. You needed a job, I guess, or maybe a better job than you already had.
Well, I wanted, you know, I went to school. I didn't go to like a film scoring program. I just went to a regular music program. I studied composition and I studied performance. Mm-hmm. And then I met a guy who had a friend who owned a music house in the city, and you know, they did like jingles and mm-hmm. stuff for TV and whatever, and I'd never really thought about it, but that mm-hmm. so I was like, oh, that's a job.
And you were pretty young, so
yeah. So well, I mean, I grew up with, you know, like the soundtrack to Star Wars and all. I mean, every kid I knew had that,
right?
And all kinds of other things. But yeah, then it really occurred to me that I should get a job, and that was a possibility. So I ended up working there, and then I started scoring films, like for students at NYU and SVA and Columbia.
Roughly, what years would that be?
Late '90s.
Okay.
I think 2000. Yeah, I met late 2000. I met Howard, and I started working up there. So Lord of the Rings, Gangs of New York.
Never heard of those.
Yeah.
Sorry.
We did David Cronenberg's Spider. We did that.
I don't remember that one.
That's a smaller one with Ralph Fiennes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And A Panic Room, mm-hmm. David Fincher.
Oh, sure, sure. So pretty big stuff.
Yeah. I mean, it was a great, you know, I was there 3-4 years. Got to work on top studios and stuff.
It's amazing opportunity, right?
Yeah, and to see what was really great about that was seeing seeing the way one composer interacts with these different directors, you know, great directors,
right.
You know.
But he was also, I'm sorry, go ahead, Jeff.
Well, there's just a lot of stuff that, you know, when you go and when you watch a film and you listen to the score in the film, you don't know what the conversations between the filmmakers mm-hmm. were, and between the composer and the director, and you know, you have no idea about any of that stuff.
Sure.
And so to kind of be a fly on the wall for that stuff was very interesting, you know.
And that must have helped tremendously as you're evolving into your own role of composer.
Yeah, I think a composer, you kind of figure, you know, everybody's different, right? And it's just like creative choices that you're doing all the time, and everybody makes different choices, and that's what makes you. So for me, it was a matter of figuring out, like, oh, this person does this, and let me try that. And okay, that thing, yeah, that's really great. I like that. That's something that's useful for me, then that works for me. And then other things might not work as well for you, or you can't pull them off the same way as that person does. And so over time, and that was the other great thing about working with Howard, was I just met a lot of other composers mm-hmm. like on a very that were working on a very high level, and then you just so over time and their assistants, and you learn how different people work and they do things and how they approach things. And
hello,
yeah, who's that?
I don't know.
So that was all really great. It was kind of, you know, it's like pulling back the curtain and mm-hmm. you see things.
Right.
There's things you don't even know to ask until
you don't know what you don't know.
Exactly.
So yeah. You know, it's interesting because there's a handful, I think, of celebrity composers. Certainly Howard Shore would fall in there. And Larry mentioned Danny Elfman. There's you know, of course, John Williams and a bunch of others, mostly male-dominated as I think about it.
Hans, there's Hans.
Yeah, mein Kommandant, continue. What were you saying? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you knew my nickname. What were you saying? Hans?
Hans Zimmer.
Hans Zimmer, of course, among others. And I imagine their experience is different. Like, you know, they're huge, and so people are, you know, they're coveted. Like, if I could get Howard Shore, you know, this is going to be a dream. Now, but the good thing about when you entered, you know, the next phase is all of a sudden there's this resurgence of all these kids coming out making these horror films, which were definitely homages in some cases to 80s horror. But all of a sudden there seems to be this whole generation, roughly your age, maybe slightly, I don't know, and all of a sudden you're in demand.
Yeah, well, and part of that was thanks to Larry.
He's on my payroll. No, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, I met Larry, producer friend of ours, Peter Polk. I met Peter, I think, at an IFP, you know, Independent Feature Project, some kind of event they were having. I met him when I was getting ready to leave Howard's, and then he called me some time later saying, hey, I'm producing this film for this young director, Ty West, and that ended up being The Roost, which was Ty's first feature film, yeah. And Larry, one of the many films of his that Larry produced, and that's how I met Larry, and then from there, we just started doing a lot of stuff together, and then I think the next thing I did with them was Larry's movie, The Last Winter.
Mm-hmm. All these filmmakers have been on my show. Kelly's been on. And Larry, of course, several times. And Jim Mickle and Ty West has been on in a couple of months when Bitten the Valley of Violence comes out. So I'm saying that retroactively, or maybe that's not the right term. Larry, you're going to help me get Ty on, right?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
We all can control Ty. Yep, we tell him what to do.
Okay, yeah. Because, you know, he's like, I'm going to be nervous, I think, around him because... I'm such a fan. You know, he's, I think, The Innkeepers and The House of the Devil. You know, I had Tom Noonan on, and I said to him, you really carry this movie, don't you? And he reminded me, he's like, I'm not in 80% of it. I disappear for like 80% of it. I'm like, well, that's how, you know, great an actor I think you are. So,
well, it's funny because, of course, Tom Noonan was our big ace in the hole when we made The Roost.
I thought that was Jeff Grace. Regs. Oh, you're ahead of me. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, no, it was a big deal. We had this concept that we'd make these low-budget films, but we'd get something that would tie it to, you know, the history of horror and some sort of exciting component. And in that case, it was Tom Noonan. He's the horror host of The Roost. There's sort of a wraparound story. And actually... Jeff has some fun organ music there. Most of that score is very Penderecki style, slashing strings. But then there's some quite funny intro music for the horror host, played by Tom Noonan.
Oh, right. He's a musician. Is that what he's saying?
He's saying that the music that plays under this the host bit is... it's like this organ.
Oh, that he's playing. That he's.
Well, it just plays when he's on the screen.
Oh, I see. He's got his own like.
Yeah, and that's theme kind music. Of a set because or, narratively that's like saying. A wraparound for the story.
Sure.
So that's completely different than the rest of the film and the rest of the score. But yeah.
I want to go back and see it again, but I'm too terrified. I mean, it's seriously one of the scariest movies. I mean, you fucked Greta Gerwig up big time. You fucked her up. I'm like, that's just wrong. I mean.
Oh, for House of the Devil?
House of the Devil now.
Yeah.
Yeah. What were you thinking of?
Oh, yeah. She got shot in the head.
Yeah. That was just
spoiler point. Alert.
Yeah, exactly. This part could come out. I want to ask you a question, Jeff, and also, you know, Blake, jump in. Blake Fichera. Oh, by the way, we're talking about Blake's book. It's called Scored to Death, Conversations with Some of Horror's Greatest Composers, which is currently available where books are sold. I got my copy from the publisher, so what can I tell you guys? But I know this is available also on, obviously, all the Amazons and Barnes & Nobles of the world.
Yes, yeah. It is very available. Buy in bulk.
But buy a bunch of them. They make lovely gifts. You know, get a head start. Halloween is around the corner.
Perfect book for mom.
Blake, just also say you've got a couple of appearances coming up, too. I know one is really soon, so that probably I won't get the show up in time, but you're also going to Burbank? When's that?
August 21st.
Maybe I could aim for that then.
Maybe I'll be in Burbank at Dark Delicacies Bookstore.
Okay.
Doing a signing, and a number of the composers in the book who are on the West Coast are going to be there with me.
So that's fantastic.
It should be a great time.
Yeah. Is there a community there? Do you guys like all hang out and have pizza and scream at each, like hide behind doors and yell at each other? And
Jeff's the only person I spoke to who's here on the East Coast. But it seems that everybody on the West Coast knows each other pretty well.
I
had dinner with some of them, and you know, Joseph Bashara was like, oh, Nathan emailed me today, and you know, like he can't show up, and that like they all seem to know each other pretty well, and and even though it's you know, they span ages and stuff, I guess you guys probably do a lot of festivals and conventions and stuff like that. I think they probably get
when you're
working
cool.
in the same kind of thing, you know, you tend to cross paths, I would assume.
I have a couple of questions about choices made as a very green listener, somebody who doesn't really know a lot about composing. I've been a songwriter, a musician myself, but I've never scored anything. But I noticed, of course, that there's a plethora of church organ music on, as we already mentioned, is very common. Any thoughts about, or a lot of choral music in Latin often?
You mean in horror scores?
I'm sorry. In horror film scores. What's that about? Jeff, have you ever used those tropes?
I think the only time I've used the organ thing is probably that thing that Larry was talking about with the roost. Mm-hmm. And the choir thing, I probably...
Oh, he was in the roost. That's what it was before. Tom Noonan was also in the roost?
He was in the roost and he was in
and
House
of
the
Devil. Yeah, oh, okay, I forgot. Okay, I'm sorry.
But the...
Just catching up, Larry. Just slow. Jesus.
There was a little bit of choir in... House of the Devil. I mean, The Innkeepers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's it.
Well, and just in
and
the
that, you know, that's like that's a ghost story. So it's kind of
makes
know,
sense. The Gregorian
we
is another
full traditional on that one.
But there's a lot, and we're going to get to a segment within this segment in a moment where I'm going to test you guys. This is a surprise. I'm ambushing you all. Larry, you can participate as well. It's a little game show thing. I'm going to play a few clips, and we're going to see. Who can name the film first?
Okay.
Well, Larry's
going to, I'll be terrible.
No, these
at
are,
it. Larry will be great.
These
at
are
it.
Actually not so hard. Most of them are yours, actually, so you should get them real quick.
I won't know. I definitely won't know. No, but to get back to what you were saying about the organ and the choir thing, I think that, just the whole liturgical thing. If with all the demonic things and
all
that kind of stuff, then it's an easy one to go to.
It's easy. But speaking of which, you also will notice, I was like watching this new show, which is now everyone is talking about, called Stranger Things. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's on Netflix. It's an original.
I've heard of it, yeah.
And it's a horror series, and they lean on synth music.
Yeah, it's very, in the way music that, is very kind of Carpenter-esque.
Yeah.
Which is kind of becoming a thing.
Yeah, is it done ironically? Is it or like as a homage?
I think it's definitely an homage. I mean, takes place in '83. And
sure.
It's very much a big plug for Stranger Things. Very much trying to play homage to the Spielberg produced stuff in the '80s, like Poltergeist.
My understanding is that the entire show is almost shot for shot or moment for moment an homage. So
yes.
I'm sure the composer was instructed to evoke those kinds of scores as well.
Yeah, in other words, this is no disrespect to the composer of Stranger Things, but it seems like it's packaged. It's all packaged. So you're kind of, I get that sense too. We're tapping into, this a certain Spielberg
I just think it's going for a certain tone that's very nostalgic for a time period. So I think the music is just part of that. I mean, it's the music has been being talked about a lot, like online and stuff. I mean, people love the music, and I love the music too. I mean, it's one of the reasons why I wrote this book is because I have nostalgia for these kinds of scores and especially the music.
But let me ask about this now in a slightly more nuanced way, which is, I know because it's a surprise to you, don't think I can do such a thing, but what is it about the synth music then that we now interpret as creepy? I mean, I guess it's always contextual. I mean, you can listen to synth music and be considered, you know, considered a kind of a, you know, upbeat type of up-tempo or whatever. I don't know. And I'm now watching it. I have an association. And when I listen to synth music on a score, I'm always now thinking this is a horror film. And I'm just wondering why it's creepy now.
I think that Carpenter was really effective at, you know, taking like a minimalist approach to things. And he's, I think it's in your book, but I've also heard him talk about this before, that basically that's he's just like working within the confines of his abilities.
But
what he does, very similar to what Bernard Herrmann did, is he takes these little melodic ideas and works them in various ways but really, really hammers away at them, and it kind of gets under the skin of the audience. And I think he's, in that way, he's very effective. He's just using a different sound palette than, say, Bernard Herrmann did. Mm-hmm. I mean, Bernard Herrmann was really the guy who just took those little melodic fragments and harmonic ideas, simple harmonic ideas, and then just really, really worked them. And it, very, very effectively. But he's the guy, that really brought that to the fore and showed how effective you can be with that.
I also think the synth thing probably came out of necessity of budget and stuff when it kind of started. I mean, Carpenter talks about it specifically,
It wasn't just,
you know,
these
were a lot of these, especially in the 70s and the 80s when a lot of this started with the synth music. I mean, these were lower budget films. And even though obviously there were budgets, like Harry Manfredini with Friday the 13th, he didn't. I mean, there's maybe some synth stuff in there, but he used, you know, a string ensemble and stuff, I think. Mm-hmm. But I think it kind of came out of a way of working cheaply, but also effectively. And Carpenter talks about it specifically. He found that the synth he could build by multi-tracking and get a bigger sound, but with just him and a keyboard. So I think that's probably where it comes from. But, you know, also, you know, Tangerine Dream and the stuff that they did with Michael Mann and Wayne Friedkin that wasn't necessarily horror-based, it's just very much of the time.
Sure.
I think with them, in the case of them, I mean, that was a very specific sound that people went to them for.
Yeah, I didn't mean to imply that they were cheap, but I was just saying my point was that it wasn't specific to horror music. I mean,
it was specific more to 80s.
I'm just saying that in that particular case, because I think you nailed it with Carpenter that he's said that, and I've read him say that in other interviews as well, that it's like it was his ability and he was what he was working with. But then there's the case when, you know, it's like whenever you get some musical artist to do something,
sure,
then the case of Tangerine Dream, that's like even Risky Business, you know, I mean, that's Tangerine Dream
Well, then even like Goblin, you know, a band that has a very specific sound. And if that's what you want, I mean, that's, you go to those guys for it.
But I think nowadays that it is the nostalgia thing that people are kind of, an homage thing that people are sort of going back to.
Right. Those who grew up in the 80s are now in late 40s.
But even your score for Cold in July has been compared to that.
Sure. And the funny thing about I actually wrote, Jim had me write some music, I think while they were shooting, or maybe just before, a little before they shot, I wrote like a few themes. And then, and a lot of that was more, originally he was thinking like sort of guitar-based Texas kind of stuff, because it takes place in Texas in the 80s. And then we had a conversation about, maybe we'll try some synth stuff too. And then just by taking that same exact material and just putting synths on it, it just went there.
Yeah,
it went to like the Carpenter place, you know. Yeah. But it wasn't. It was almost all those themes were written before on different instruments, and then it didn't. I don't think anyone would have thought, oh, that Carpenter, until you put those sounds there, you know?
Got that tone, the Carpenter tone.
Yeah, exactly, right.
The preset on the keyboard.
That's right. Dial up the Carpenter.
Also, I know from reading the book, there's, it seems to be, since vinyl, which never really went away, is definitely become very popular again, owning a vinyl collection.
Yeah.
The horror film scores have found a place in there that there's a popular format, right?
I think it kind of started as a fad and then just like went past being a fad, and now it's just like a full-blown thing. Limited edition releases, some of Jeff's scores even have been.
Even Jeff's scores.
You know, it's just like it's a wide variety. I mean, it's meaning even more contemporary scores, not just classics.
Right.
Because I think it kind of started with the 70s and the 80s and stuff, but the interest is a big thing for collectors. I mean, I started doing it while I was writing the book because I ended up finding it to be like a really valuable resource, because it was, in some cases, it was maybe the only way to get some of these scores to listen to, and they're cool, so why not?
Larry, you've directed how many films? How many features?
What's that?
Sorry, Larry. Wake up. How many? Just kidding. No, you've been neglected. How many films have you directed? Features, like 4 or 5? How many? Directed.
Something like that, yeah.
Do you have any, are there any scores of the existing?
Any scores of what?
Do you have like the soundtracks? Are there soundtracks for them? Like
all of them, yes. That's... And they're quite different. I had a wonderful composer for a movie called Wendigo, Michelle Debussy, and she brought in lots of exotic instrumentation because of the Native American theme of the Wendigo, and that was a very exciting score. And then obviously with Jeff, we wrote some wonderful things for the last winter. I've had a strange experience on two of my films. I had two composers, one that was doing a more soundscapey type of thing and one that was doing more melodic stuff. And with last winter, I had a composer who did some more synthy things, and from Jeff I wanted orchestral pieces that spoke to the romanticism of the film. So and then Habit, we also had a string quartet. I've always tried to get in the studio and use live instruments. I feel it gives a certain texture. Obviously, my kid just made a movie, and he did the score, and he was. We were doing a lot of synth beds and really having fun with that. So every movie calls for a different vibe. It's really fun. I absolutely love the musical part of a film. I know that it's ultimately going to almost identify the movie, and so I take it very seriously and have enjoyed my collaborations with the musicians. And then Jeff and I did something, it was for TV, and actually, in a way, I'm very proud. We were really on a no-fuss, no-muss agenda. I asked Jeff for some themes while I was shooting, so I had that wonderful experience of actually temping with my actual score, which is very unusual because of the way you make a film. You don't always have that luxury, and I think it's because we had to shoot so quickly. It was a show called Skin and Bones for NBC, and Jeff whipped up the score. It was wonderful.
Yeah, that was
very atmospheric.
That was for a series called Fear Itself, which is like a porting over of Showtime
Masters of Horror.
Yeah.
Oh, it's okay. Showtime.
So they did one season on NBC. Yeah.
Oh.
2008 summer, I think. Yeah.
Larry mentioned that on the one project he had two different. He was working with two different.
The last winter, you said there was another film. Larry No Telling?
No Telling. I had David Van Tegum, who's actually renowned sort of performance percussionist, and he was really excited to do this sort of synthy, moody, if you will, almost the horror score. But then in the same way, I always am torn because I make horror films, but I have a romantic soul. So I wanted my friend to write these more soaring Peter Greenway type of instrumentations. And so there I had the two. I figured out how to credit them, but they both supplied different types of music. That was for No Telling.
I was wondering when you mentioned that, maybe Jeff, you can answer this question: is how closely would a composer work with a sound designer, or editor? Maybe it's different in every film.
So. It's different. Depends on the filmmaker. Depends on a lot of different things. When you come on the project. Ty is very, very good friends with, like, childhood friends with his sound designer, Graham Resnick. All the films I've done with Ty, Graham's been there before I even got on. Mm-hmm. And so we work very closely together. And in fact, Graham actually, he's a good composer himself, and he's a very, very good director himself as well. Great writer. So he sometimes even does like some electronic music for Ty's films as well, like additional music kind of stuff. And so they're
trying to crowbar his way in.
That's right.
Got to step on him like a bug. You know what I'm saying, Jeff?
Yeah, I found out too late, you know. So, so he's a very good sound designer, and that's, you know, for Ty. To him, sound is a huge part of a film's, the audience's experience of a film. Mm-hmm. So, they're very closely related. Sometimes we will send stuff back and forth, you know. So, like, he may have a bed of something, and then I might write a cue on top of that, or I might write something, and then Ty may want some kind of thing to go around that. Sometimes in the case of something like The Innkeepers, where it was a part of the narrative, you know, when they're on the headphones and they start hearing things that when you don't have the headphones on, you don't hear them. And then when you have the headphones on, you start these things. So there's a Chopin piano piece that plays. And then of course, so there's the stuff that's diegetic, and then that was all woven in with the sound design. And then there's there's score stuff as well for some of that. It's very closely related, but then there's other times where it's kind of, you know, you're working in isolation or you have to work very, very quickly and there's no time for back and forth.
Sure. And you love those times.
Oh yeah. That's,
in and out.
Oh, yeah. That's real.
Well, let's go to, this game I put together. It's called Check Your Horror Score IQ.
Okay.
For cleverly enough. Now, these are going to be pretty, pretty straightforward, I have to say, because my own, you know, knowledge is rather limited. And we have listeners, so, you know, we want to give them let them at least have some sort of access to this stuff. So I'm not going to go too obscure here. We'll start with a couple of easy ones. I'm going to play a tune. Larry, you're going to participate, right?
Yeah, I will try. I'm not a film geek, though.
Oh, I get it. No, you don't have to be. These won't be too tough. We'll start with a couple of easy ones, in fact. Okay?
Jaws.
I don't know what you're talking about. We're doing this sort of old world.
You're going to give us the answers first, and then we're going to go?
Well, no, I was going to say I'm playing them on vinyl. No. Okay, here we go. This is okay, Larry, this is for you. Hold on, here we go. Okay.
Am I getting pumped?
Okay.
That's 60 Seconds of Silence by John Cage.
Did you not hear any of that?
No.
Oh.
It's 3 minutes and four.
Did everybody else hear that? Not Larry?
I heard it. Yeah.
Larry, one more time. I'm going to play something else because that was Jaws. But hold on. Sorry, Larry. If we can't figure this out, you might have to step out. Hold on. This should work. You should be able to hear this, though. Hold on one second. Actually, I want to see if you can hear this, Larry. One second. Here we go. Larry, did you hear that?
Well, that is Jaws.
Right. Okay. So long. Yes, it is. You stepped on my first one. I was going to give like a giveaway, like, you know, an easy one, but that you know that was funnier what you did. Okay. So here's another one. This one shouldn't be too hard for you guys.
Well, Adam, you have to laugh. That was the other joke I made.
Oh.
Was Psycho.
Okay, very good. Now, can you name the composer for extra credit?
John Williams and then Bernard Herrmann.
Okay, show off. All right,
and then
good.
Can you name what pieces they were ripping off?
Well, in this case.
What is it, the planets? No, that's Star Wars. What's the answer?
The first, oh, Jaws? I think that's right, okay. Right of spring, right?
Jaws is Sacre du Printemps by Stravinsky.
Is that true?
That's correct.
Oh, wow. So they actually had, like, referenced...
clearly influenced by that.
I thought you were going to say... Who then did Fantasia? Fantasia, the Mickey Mouse. You know, that's all Sacre du Printemps, I think.
That's something mountain, right, Jeff? But let me tell you a silly story. So when I was little, I loved Jaws so much that I built a Jaws boat and I filmed it. And I used the Stravinsky instead of the Williams.
By accident.
And it. I guess it's not that good a story. You'd have to see it, though.
It is good. And we do want to see it. Let's go to the videotape. Wait a minute. I can't do that. It's a podcast. I'd love to see that. You still have something like that hanging around? Come on.
Of course. It's online somewhere.
Is it really?
Sure. Okay. If you go to IMDb and you look up Jaws, there are two versions.
Oh.
One by Spielberg and one by me.
Very good.
There's no shark, though, but it was a low-budget picture.
I can't wait to see it. I'm serious. Okay, here's another one. This is also – this should be pretty straightforward. So don't get nervous, Blake. You look like you're sweating a little bit. Okay, here we go. Okay. That's a clue right there. Because everybody repeats that part.
That's the clue.
Okay. Nobody wants it. It's too easy for everybody.
Well, it's Friday the 13th.
Thank you.
Harry Manfredini. And he talks about in the book how people compare that piece to Bernard Herrmann. And he's like, well,
I love that.
You know, and everybody's like, and his mentality is, if you are, then I did a good job. Like, I'll take it.
Of course, you can see playing them back to back like that. It's certainly evident. Okay, I'm going to go a little bit harder now, at least as far as the listening audience is concerned. Maybe this is a little bit more obscure, just a little bit more. Beautiful.
Well, yes.
Yeah, we made reference to it, so.
Yeah, it's Suspiria.
I know these Goblin, are very easy, but come on, it's for the audience. Yes.
Yeah, I mean.
Who wrote that one?
A band called Goblin, Italian band.
Okay.
Probably their most famous.
You talk about that in the book, in the intro to the book, right?
See, these are all opportunities for you to plug your book.
In a lot of ways, the inspiration of the book came from my going to a Goblin concert and realizing that a band who was still thought of as being obscure in the mainstream sense, but never had the popularity to even come into America in their heyday, which was the 70s. Now, all these years later, can tour the world and fill houses.
Now? Even now?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because of this resurgence of later. Like this love for horror music. Right. And being in that concert, seeing just like this group of people being totally into the show was just like,
right,
man, like,
who else is going?
And I went and I was like, I want to read about Goblin, but because they're Italian, there's not really much to read other than like Wikipedia, and so that's in a lot of ways that's where the inspiration for the book itself came from, being at a Goblin show.
Speaking of Italian, you mentioned also before when we were hanging out that you said there's one composer, one of the Italian composers who you had an email with, right? And he sent you over the phone.
And talked to the person over the phone was with Fabio Frizzi, who is an Italian composer who is best known for his work with the director Lucio Fulci. I think it was because of the language barrier. He didn't want to do it kind of as an audio interview. So I was allowed to submit a number of questions via email. And then he told me I would get them by a certain time. That time came and went. And I was like, am I going to
Can I get the answers to these questions?
Yeah, I've spent all of my advance already. I got to get this book done, you know.
And then he was basically like, I don't have time to do them. But okay. So what he did was he sent me an audio recording.
Oh, an audio.
In Italian. Like an MP3 of him answering my questions in Italian. Yeah. And then I had to go and hire a translator. And then the first translator kind of stunk, so then I had to hire another translator. Because the only budget of the book went from went into the translation of this 6-page interview in the book.
That's funny. All right, let's get back to more importantly to the game show here. Okay, I'm going to try to find one that's a little harder. Here we go. Okay. It's creepy. You know it, Jeff? Come on, Jeff. You don't know it? You must know it. Oh, see, there's that Bernard Herrmann influence. Mixed with the Latin choral stuff, though. Anybody? Larry? Go ahead. Anybody?
I can't hear it, but is it the Omen?
Yes.
Yeah. That's pretty good. Dude, I can't even hear it. Oh,
you can't even hear. I don't know why you can't hear it. Maybe another
one of your earlier.
The track is called actually Ave Satini, which I think is a really funny name. Satini, like it's so unsubtle. Jerry Goldsmith.
I think that was the only celebrity score that he got an Oscar for, right?
That I don't know.
We'll take your word for that. Okay, last one. Well, let's just... this one I know that Jeff will get because I think he talks about it in his interview with...
That doesn't mean I'll get it.
Okay, here we go.
Lord of the Rings.
No, but it's one of Larry's favorites also.
I can't understand why Larry can't hear this.
In fact, Larry talks about this in... he talks about this in the foreword.
All right, that's enough, since you know what it is.
Larry, were you able to hear that?
Nope.
Oh, it's turning into Wendy Carlos' score for The Shining.
Exactly.
Oh, The Shining.
Yeah, I'm going to hold it up to my mic. There's no reason why you shouldn't be able to hear that. I can't technically understand why. Anyway, okay, and finally, I do want to end with those are all movies that probably the most recent one is 30 years old. So I'm going to end with this more contemporary one, and if you could... Let's see who knows it. I'm going to hold it up to my mic now, to my speaker, Larry, so maybe you should be able to hear this, I think.
Okay.
Because it's not fair. Yeah, I don't know how you got the Omen. You couldn't even hear it.
You said crawl. That's all.
That's incredible. You're just a dynamo. Hold on. Say again?
It Follows?
Correct. Do you know the composer?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
It's okay. It's okay. He's got a great handle. He uses
what is it? Disaster piece.
Correct. Disaster piece, aka Richard Vreeland. Okay, so I think, you know, this is split evenly among everybody. Everybody did really well. So your what is it? The prize, the parting gifts? It's you don't have to come back on the podcast ever again, and I don't think anybody can top that. Consolation, that's what I was saying. Consolation prize. That's for losers, right?
That's for the second.
That's for the
second,
loser second to console place. Them as they leave the.
Yeah, it's the second place. Second, prize
right, it's a consolation.
Got a 6-pack of beer or something.
Yeah, you, Larry, very good by the way, but
Thank you. It
is odd that you got as many correct when you couldn't hear them, but.
I'll be honest. I was just on your wavelength. I actually didn't know if that was It Follows, but I suspected that was the right one to choose.
See, that's what's...
When you said you had a modern score. The guy who programs for TIFF,
Yeah, I know them.
Mm-hmm. To Toronto International Film Festival, he says that half the movies were temp scored with It Follows. So it's definitely the current favorite horror score, I'd say.
Well, I am going for stuff that's more accessible because, you know, I doubt many people that might be listening in no, there's truly, truly more obscure ones, right?
Yeah, but I mean, I'm a fan of the stuff that's celebrated and that is iconic. So there's nothing wrong with, choosing the stuff that really lasts.
Right. No. And it really is a good. I mean, I love that movie. I thought that was really well done.
I agree.
Well, winding down here, thank you, everybody, for coming in and really putting up with all this. I know it's not easiest thing to schedule everything when there's so many moving parts to it. So I really do appreciate it. Everybody's flexibility. We've been talking about Blake Fichera's book, Scored to Death, Conversations with Some of Horror's Greatest Composers, one of whom, wait for it, Jeff, I don't know why I did that. Jeff Grace is here, and Larry Fessenden, who wrote the foreword to the book. With all that's going on with Glass Eye Picks, anything you want to mention, by the way, while we're on the subject of Glass Eye Picks, Larry? Anything coming out? Anything new? Anything exciting?
No, just same old crap. But do come visit the website, glasseyepicks.com, and see what we're up to. We've got some stuff.
Now in its fourth decade. Did I make that up? You had like a big anniversary. I don't remember. Was it 30 years?
No, you're absolutely right. It's our fourth decade.
Well, I'm saying you're now started your fourth decade. The day after the 30th anniversary is the beginning of your 40th decade. No?
Making crap for over 30 years. That's our motto.
That's a great motto. I love it.
Yeah. On a budget. On a budget.
Making cheap crap.
For over 30 years.
Jeff, we have a Valley of Violence. Ty West's new film's coming out in October, so you'll have your name all over that, and hopefully they'll be selling vinyl copies of the score in the lobby.
Hey, that'd be great.
Of various theaters, I'm sure it's going to be
fantastic score, by the way. Another notch in Jeff's belt.
No doubt, and that stars actor Ethan Hawke, right?
No, it stars Larry Fessenden.
Oh,
Ethan Hawke.
My bad.
With supporting players John Travolta and Ethan Hawke.
That's correct.
John who? Okay, and Blake.
He's an old timer. We threw him a bone.
Yeah, it was nice of you. I got to get time on the show now. I purchased John Travolta, and it's a Western meets. Quasi-horror?
It's a Western. It's got some intense, pretty violent moments in it.
Okay.
And it's got an awesome dog.
Oh, I can't wait to see it.
Awesome dog.
Blake, you have not only a brand new book, but you also have a podcast you co-host.
I do.
Okay. In fact, we did an episode or segment some months ago with you and your podcast co-host. And this is called Saturday Night Sleepovers.
Saturday Night Movie Sleepovers.
Movie Sleepovers, which is a great podcast. Search for it on whatever your podcast app is, whether it's iTunes or Stitcher or one of the others. You'll find it. It's there. And you should check it out because it's a lot of fun. Larry, you should check that out, by the way.
I look forward to it.
Sounds like two guys drunk and just sick on pizza, talking about their favorite movies they grew up on. It's a lot of fun. And did you have any more scores, by the way, Jeff? I cut you off. I apologize. Any other movie projects coming out that you're participating with?
We got the second season of Happen Leonard, Jim Mickle's show.
Okay.
That'll be
what is that playing on?
That's on the Sundance Channel, and it airs on AMC as well.
Oh.
That will be, they're shooting in the fall, so, look for it late winter, early spring, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's, Kelly Reichert's, her film Certain Women will be coming out, I think. Larry, you know when that comes out, like October or something?
Certain Women will be out in right after the New York Film Festival.
That's right.
So
I was going to mention
September, October.
It's going to be at the New York Film Festival.
Yes,
and Larry,
and then I think it opens right away.
Right? Are you producer on that, Larry?
I was indeed. Yep.
Congratulations.
I tried to get a different composer, but we ended up with Jeff. come on! I'm kidding.
I know. We know you're kidding by default. Come on. What are you? So all of a sudden going to come so... Become, I was at the beginning, you sounded like you were getting real serious, and I was like, what have you done with Larry? But your true colors have come out, and thank God. silly guy. No, thank you, Larry, for phoning in, and I appreciate it.
Absolutely. It's fun to be on.
Thank you for that.
Sorry, I didn't see you guys.
No problem. Just consider it a favor to you.
And thank you. And also, Larry, thank you for writing the foreword to the book. It was very nice of you to do
pleasure.
So.
Great pleasure. I appreciate you asking, because I really I do feel music is such an essential part of the cinematic experience. So I'm happy to help highlight it.
Thank you.
Great book.
Okay, everybody. Thanks so much.
Bye.
All right, bye-bye.